Hello there, amazing and wonderful geeky people of YouTube. Today we are going to basically make a OS, or not an OS, a respin. We are going to make our own Ubuntu respin in a program called Cubic. And this is basically how I make my respins, and this is also how you can basically take Ubuntu and customize it as you want. And I'm saying Ubuntu because it's an Ubuntu program. It also works with Ubuntu derivative like Mint, Elementary OS. I actually tried it with Elementary OS, Sovereign. Basically any ISO that have a Ubuntu base, it should work on. And this is going to be a long video because we are actually going to build an ISO. How I build an ISO that make it look kinda like this. Okay? So get something to drink and stuff like that, get some snacks, and if some of you want to put timestamp in, put them down in the comment and I will pin it. But anyway, first of all we need to get Cubic, so I will just search Cubic. And then I type in Ubuntu, it's already there. So we're going to, they have a launch pads page here. Ding 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 ding. Okay, we are back in here, I don't know, there it was a little bit slow. Let's go in here and get Cubic. So basically just copy paste these commands in. Okay, that should be done. And then we have to do an update. And we need to install it. Let's see if that's going to be a problem again. Nope. So we have done that. Let's just keep that up there. And we can remove that. We want to go into system, Cubic, put in our password. So this is the program. Let's minimize that one up here. This is the program and it's a Ubuntu ISO creator. You could try it out with other ISOs. I don't know if it works, but we want to make a directory we can work out of. So I'll just create a new one and call it test1. And this is basically where it will put like the temporary file system and all that jazz. So it's called test1, select it, click next. Now we need to select an ISO and I have actually downloaded Subuntu, so we go in here, we select that one, select it. Now you can give it some parameters down here. This is basically how it will look like. So this is the version, so we'll just call it 1. File name, so this is the file name of the ISO, my ISO, desktop MD, blah blah, director, we need to have that volume ID. So just call it test run. Release name, Bob, and that's it, then click next. And now it will then uncompress the ISO, put it into the test one folder here, basically make a virtual file system and all that jazzle. So it will take a little bit of time. And this is also, if you quit it up here, we will actually do that in a second when it has done this, because you can actually work on this and then you can come back to it later, which I think is actually really amazing. So now it had made your virtual Linux system and now you see root into it. Basically you are working as root inside a virtual file system. So this is basically you working inside your ISO. This is where you do all the work. So if you click quit up here, you can see it removed that squash, or it removed the file system there. So if we go back in here and you want to continue working on it, go in here, we select the directory and it was test run, select that one, click next. Now it asks us, do you want to make a disk image, basically an ISO? No, we don't want to do that. Do we want to continue or do we want to delete it? Well, we want to continue it. So we'll just highlight that one, click next. And I have heard some people say that this program is not that good and stuff like that. I have run it for hours and worked on it for hours in a virtual machine. Had no problem at all. I've also done it on my physical hardware. Have no stability issues at all. So like I said, we are inside our distro that we want to make. So in here, you're basically working off the Subuntu installation distribution. So you can take away pre-installed programs, you can install other programs. And what I do, I have this project one. This is basically my work folder for my distribution. I recommend that you guys do that. Make lists. I have to say what I have done. So this is basically things, steps that I want to do. Disregard this one up here. That was from a previous build. I could actually just delete that, to be honest. But these are the programs I want to install. These are the programs I want to remove. Then .files needs to be installed. A .phase file needs to be installed. Then I need to finish the control center. I have done that, so I can just remove that one. And the .phase file is basically this one I have down here. You don't have to do that, but your .files are the files in your... If we go in here and we go show hidden files, this is what I call these, the config files. And we are using XFCE, so we're just taking the config files from this here, but I will show you how to do that when we get there. So for now, we don't want to show hidden files. Let's just go back. Oh, let's go into the project folder. I also have some dev files in here I want to install. We'll get into that. So let's save that one. And the reason why, you know, you could go in here and... Oh, before I go into this, work with this as... Just think of you being a root user inside Linux, basically, because that's what you are. The Linux just happens to be the Subuntu ISO. Again, all the software that they have packed into that ISO is in here. You can then add and retract hardware, software, not hardware, but you can basically do apt remove and then put all of them into one command. The reason why I do them one by one is in case that something fucks up. So I will do this, you know, like this one at a time. So I will remove GIMP. Then I will remove LibreOffice. And I just middle mouse button to paste in the command. I will remove that one. You get my idea here? And I do the same for install. And it's just if there is a problem or it don't fetch a program at the right time. Oh, sorry. And stuff like that. You could end up with it not working. I have tried to put them all into one command. And then, oh, the repo was like down for like a split second, or you have misspelled a program and stuff like that. And then you have to like look at all the big list of programs, which one have you misspelled and stuff like that. I just find this to be, it's a little bit like double checking your work, because you only have, each command you do, you only have one point of failure. Where if I do all this into one big command, I have a lot of point of failures, basically. It was transmission GTK. So what I do is also I just give it a space so I know that I have done this. You get what I'm saying here? I could theoretically just do this, to be honest, instead of just copying the name of the program. Do this. It is a little bit more time consuming, but like I said again, let's just say you put all these into one and this one here breaks, or you did a spelling mistake. Then you have to troubleshoot which one was the spelling mistake and all that. Here, because I'm doing them one by one, I know where the spelling mistake, you know, I know, oh, pidgin didn't work. And transmission, that's why I made that not a capital letter, because I did that before and it was like, we cannot find transmission and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, what's going on here? It's just, you know, making sure that things work as they should do. If you want to remove a lot of programs, yes, it makes sense to put all of these into one command. But I just like doing it this way. Maybe I'm a little bit anal. I don't know. It's possible that I'm an anal motherfucker with this here. That was not in there. I'm actually these. This list is actually made out of the beta, or no, daily build. These are all stuff that I did with the daily build. So let's copy that one. And there you go. And then I just want to auto remove. And we are saving 100 and something megabyte. So we have done that. There you go. Now we are going to install all these up here. And sometimes, like I said, if you're trying to install a program, it could act up, so you may need to go in and do apt update. Don't do an apt upgrade. I try to do that, it can mess up your ISO, so just do an apt update to update the I actually totally messed that up. There you go. Apt update. It helps to refresh the repositories and stuff like that. Don't do an upgrade. I tried to do upgrade and it was like 50-50 if it worked. I don't know why. It just didn't work all the time. So just only do updates, you know, update the repositories. And it will say, oh, there's upgrades. Do them. Don't do them. I don't know why. It will just, you can see there's 26 packages that need to be upgraded. So as you can see, we are basically treating this as if it was a physical Linux machine. That's the really, that's why I love working in this mode here. You're basically in a terminal in a Linux machine and doing all kind of things that you want. You know, you can basically do all the things that you would could do under this terminal here. I can go, I can open HTOP if I want and stuff like that. And it's actually really, really, really amazing. So I'm actually showing you guys right now how I built Hello OS, my Ubuntu vSpin. This is exactly what I did.
This is the one. These are the files. These files were basically one. Then we have FlameShop. And I don't know the same reason why we use one of them. It's the easiest to know where you are. So if you like, say, don't want a program, you decide why you don't want that. I don't know. It's like game mode is not even necessary. And see, no suites. I don't need that anymore. And see, obviously, didn't space. I can't remember what the next one. So let's do this. Not that many. I like the only because I installed. No, see, I don't need GS. I have to connect in there. Okay, so we do GS. Not that motherfucker. Put in there. Power line. And we have FlameShop. And we have tools.
Again, I know this is tedious and I know this is like not the fastest way to do it. I just find it, it's the, for me, I can keep track of what I'm doing it like this. You could, like I said, do all the programs in one line. So we are done that. That's all the tedious work out. So I'll save that in case something goes wrong. So install dev files, that's my own programs, but let's go into customizing the ISO. So I have a light DM here. We need to have our themes installed first. So we actually need the themes that I'm using for this distribution here. So if you go into file system, user or USR, share, and then we can just take icons first. There you go. These are the icons that we have. And let's see if I can. It's Merida icons that I'm using. But we need to go into that directory over here also. So we want to go into CD, USR, share, icons. Again, treat this window here, I was pointing with my finger, you can't see this, treat this window here as it was a physical box. So to copy stuff over from your physical box to your ISO, you need to be in the directory you normally put it. So if we ls this one here, you can see there's already icons in here. But we want this one here, we want that one, that's in the cursor, we want that one, that's a cursor. I think that's it. And this is like really, really easy. You just drag and drop them, boy, and then you click copy, and it takes no time to copy files over. Now the when this is done, they're in there. So if we do ls again, you can see they're in there. A little bit hard to see, but you get my idea. Okay, now we want to go into themes. And you can see there's already themes in there. Again, we are working inside an ISO basically right now. And we are treating it as a physical machine here. Themes. And we are using blank. Just drag it over. Copy it. And again, you can also remove themes. So if you don't want, like, let's just remove a theme here. Like, we don't want, let's see, Numix. So we just do, I think this is how we do it. It's not there anymore. So you, it's really, really easy. So now we have our themes and stuff like that installed. So what's the next thing we have to do? Let's think. Maybe I should have put them down in a text over here. So we have the themes installed. Oh, now we actually just need to do the .dot files, you know, the config files. So to make sure that your system has, I need to get off my chair because I'm falling down. So there's something in a system called a SKELs folder. That's basically a skeleton template for how a new user will look like when it's created under your Ubuntu system. So every time you create a new user, it will have these configuration. So we want the new user when we create it, and when the installer is creating that new user, we want it to look like what we have it right here. You know, we want the layout of the bar, we want the theming, you want the icon set right, we want the desktop layout and the wallpapers and all that. Which reminds me, we need to go in and install some wallpapers also. But let's go in and do that skill folder first. And it's located, as I said, in etc and then SKEL for skeleton. But I think of it as a template. You know, it's a template for how a new user should look like when it's being created. And if you look in here, there's basically nothing. And if you do it like this, you can see this. .bash/rc, there's config, we need to go into that one. But we also need to install the bash/rc file. So we get, you know, we install Powerline. So we get Powerline to working by default. So we need to install our bash/rc. So if we go back into our home folder, review, whoops, come here, show hidden files. And we might as well just install the phase file. Is the phase file already there? No. So let's install that. Drag it over. Copy it. There you go. And we want to remove bash/rc. So if it ls all, you can see bash/rc is not here anymore. We find our bash/rc. This is from my running system. Drag that in there. Copy that one. So now when you're using, every new user that will be created when you have installed this to your hard drive will have a terminal that looks like this. You get the idea here? So now we need to install some config files, and you can install any config files you want or turn them over, or not turn them over, copying them to get, basically customize it as your heart content. So let's go into cd.config, and then if you list that one or look at the directory, you can see we have XSCE4, we have TrollTech, we have LibreOffice and stuff like that. So let's just say you have, like, you want some configuration you've done with Thuna in here. You've done some specific customization. Well, you basically just drag this folder over here, and then when you boot up your ISO, it will have those, when you boot up the ISO and install your ISO into your hard drive, each user that you then create also under the installation of that ISO will have these configurations. But we want to basically just, XFCE is so fucking amazing because every customization, like the theming and all that, is done under the XFCE folder in .config. So we basically just remove the already existing XFCE folder. So if we list again, it's not there. Then we take our folder with all our configuration of the theming, layout of icons and cursor theme, wallpaper and blah, 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 blah. Put that into our ISO and we are copying that sucker. And if we then list it again, it's in there. You don't have to do anything with the root directory, just putting that out there. And don't include these two here, because then you will not get a... let me see here. Then you will not get a desktop folder. And you will not get desktop icons by default. It will mess it up royally. I've run into that many, many times. So wallpapers, I can't remember where, because we need to put in wallpapers because we set them up. So we're going a little bit backwards here, but it's in USR. Sierra. Oh, that's not how we do it. That's definitely not how. Oh, I cannot remember how to spell that now. There you go. And then we can list and see where do we have anything called backgrounds. Because I think that's where I have this one installed. Yes, under user share backgrounds XFCE. Because then we'll have this desktop that we have here. So we need to find backgrounds. List that one. We have Graybird and we have XFCE. So we'll do CD XFCE. And then we will just drag in all our wallpapers. You can see here, it actually helps that you already have, you know, layout here. So the themes are just installed. I already in here, or to be honest, they are in here. Oh, we also have to do our Playmouth startup splash screen. So let's do that one. So I will just go into... So we have installed the wallpapers now, so it knows where to look for the wallpapers that we have set here. So now I want to go into my root folder. I think that's it. Yeah. Because we want to do some temporary things. I think this is the one. Yeah. Ubuntu Touch. Install Ubuntu Touch. Is that this? This is allowed to run. So if we drag that in there, copying it. And then if we list that one, we have it there. So we will cd into Ubuntu Touch. See what we have here. We have installed Ubuntu Touch. So it's basically to install the startup screen. I actually need to make this a little bit wider because there's coming some command here. So we'll just do install, press enter. And now it asks us, what do we want to do? Press enter to keep the current choice or select a number. So if you look here, we have Ubuntu Touch. If you look here, that's the one we want, so we have to press 1. So we press 1. And this is also how you would install this splash screen on your physical hardware. Test, 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 test. It's doing some tests right now. If you want to restore, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, just click enter. Let's clear that one. So now we need to do some fixes. So basically makes it more responsive, to be honest. So we do that one. And I got all these from GNOME Looks, by the way. This splash screen here. There you go. Then we will CD out of it. Then we have to remove, you know, the Ubuntu Touch. But we don't need to have that. Because if you keep this right now, when you're making your ISO, this will be on your ISO. And when you are installing your ISO, this will be installed on the root in your new file system that you make on your hard drive. So, of course, we want to remove this little... child here, what you will call this little sucker here. So now that's removed. So if you press ls, it's removed. So let's go back here. We have install icons, dot files. I normally put my x. This is actually the vanilla theming that I wanted. So I always customize XFCE as I wanted. Then I take the config file here and put it into the project folder here. So no matter what I do on my system, I always have a backup here of my vanilla XFCE setup. But we're almost done. Now we just need to install the... Or I would install these. I don't want to do that with you guys right now. So I'll basically just copy the dev file so I want, and then to use dpkgi and then install dev packages. You know, that's the desktop install and all that. But for the most part, you don't want to... Like, this is something I do. And... I don't see a reason why to do this under this video here, because it will just be useless, to be honest. Oh yeah, we have the light DM creator here. So basically, this is how I have customized my login screen. This is the folder forward. And I think it's in etc that that is. I can't remember. Let's see if I can etc. LightDM. Is that it? Oh, that's it. So I've taken this file out of the config file from my physical system. So let's just take it from my physical system to make it a little bit more understandable. User, where's etc? That's not definitely not the right folder I'm in here. I'm so stupid. And then we need to go into LightDM, and here we have the file. So you get the idea here what I have done with this what I have done with this project one. I basically just, what I've did was I installed Ubuntu, removed the programs I didn't want, installed the programs I want, documented this in this file here so I knew what to do with the ISO. I customized XFCE, I took the configuration files and put them in here. Then I customized the creator or the display manager, and then I basically just took that file and copied over here. So all the files I had to copy over to my ISO to customize it, I didn't have to go into my physical file system and then, you know, oh, I have to go to icons, I have to go to themes, like we actually did that, but we don't have to do that if you just back it all up into one folder. That's why I have this project one folder here. These two files here are the same. It's just to make the workflow a little bit easier. But let's remove this like the DTK conf, because we don't need that. We want our own, so just drag that over there, copy it, whoop, and Bob's your uncle. That's it. I think we are done now. We have the wallpapers, we have done all our themings. We have, this is my test folder for programming. We have, theoretically, I would have installed the programs I want from in here. Or if you have dev files you have downloaded from you know, the web that you want to install, put them into a folder so you know where they all are. And we have copied over our configuration file into the scale folder. Now it's basically just to build the ISO. And it can take, depending on your speed of your CPU and RAM and all that, it takes X amount of time. It can be fast, it can be slow. I have allocated 4 cores and 4 gigabytes for this VM here. So we just click next. And now it will unmount all these virtual file systems and do its stuff. Now it asks us the package manifest. So if you had a minimalistic install also, it will ask you which one should be removed under the normal install and which one should be removed under the minimalistic install. So select packages that will be automatically removed after a typical a minimal installation and stuff like that. So let's just say I want Gparty to be a part of my ISO. But I don't want it to be automatically installed when they're installing the ISO. So you will install Gparted. It will then be on this list here. And then you can go in and say, oh, I don't want it. So you'll just take it here. And then it will not be installed when the system is being installed from the ISO onto the hard drive. So I don't know if there's anything here we don't want, just for the sake of it, that's up here. Let's see. Well, we install Audacity. Let's just say we don't want Audacity to be installed onto our hard drive, but we want it to be on our ISO for some crazy weird-ass reason, because, let's just say aliens, because of aliens, okay? You go in here to the kernel, so if you did an update or you installed your own kernel, you can actually choose what kernel you want to boot. Then there's pre-seed files, and there's ISO boot configuration. I have fiddled around much with these kind of things here. I would just recommend you guys to only mess around with this. Look over it here and be really, really careful. I basically just keep it as default, to be honest. But let's generate our ISO. So now it's basically generate our ISO. Where will it put set ISO, you say? Well, remember that working folder we made here. It will actually put it in here. And it will then be called whatever we named it under the scheming convention we gave it here. So this could take a little bit of time, so we'll just pause the video and then I will show you the finished ISO. And we are back. I actually forgot to pause it and stop the recording. I'm stupid. It's only like 9 o'clock in the evening and I'm fucking stupid. But I did this, it's done. And it took me, I'll say 4 minutes on this little system here. If you do HTOP. You see I have like 4 cores, 4 gig of RAM. So if you have like even more cores, it will do it even faster. Okay, so it's really, really fast compared to how to do it with ARTs and stuff like that. That's what I like. So let's close that down. As you guys can see in here in our test one folder, we have the ISO and we have a checksum. So what you do is you can click finish. You can also click quits if you want. And then it gives you a summary here. And then if you don't want to work on the on this at all anymore, you check this one down here and you just click close and it will delete this folder basically. But then all your hard work is done. What I would recommend is you don't delete it. You click close, you test out your ISO, and you basically see if there's anything you forgot, because there's always something you forgot, or there's a configuration that don't work or something like that. And then you can basically, just like I showed you before, open it again, select the directory, and then ask you, do you want to create an image? Do you want to continue customizing it, or do you want to delete it? So you just click continue customizing, and then you're back into the CH root system, where you are basically in a virtual Linux machine, and then you do your things that you forgot, or remove some stuff. Maybe you figured out, oh, I don't want that program, I want another program. It's really, really flexible like that. And then you when you are done and happy with your ISO, you still don't delete the test folder, because if you want to put it out to the public, you put your ISO out to the peoples of the masses, and then let them run with it for like, let's say, 2 weeks to a month. And after that, yeah, you could maybe delete the test. You can delete this one folder here, because at that point, most bug fixes that you can do yourself should be mentioned to you, or, you know, request from people, you know, oh, can you, it's not working here, can you include this program here? So, because if you don't do that, then you have to do ISOs each week or stuff like that. So it's up to your temperament, basically. But anyway, I hope this was a little bit helpful. I'll see you all later. Bye-bye.